Chapter 18. Pugnacs had increased in girth as well as wealth over the 3 years since Atreides had last seen him. His cropped hair was graying at the temples, and the lines in his face had deepened. Atreides took in the grander surroundings, well aware that the largesse had come from the mural painted on the front of the inn, depicting himself in combat. He couldn't read the sign, but had a good idea what it said.
"Sayar and Yavelam,"
Pugnacs said, noting the ivory chip hanging from the gold chain around Atreides' neck. He admired Rispa, if not the babe in her arms, adding with a grin,
"And have more to show for it than I."
Atreides didn't like the way Pugnacs stared at Rispa.
"I needed to earn enough money to make the journey back to Germania."
Pugnacs gave a hard laugh.
"You carry a vain hope, Atreides. You can't go back. You're no more German any more than I'm a Gaul. Speak for yourself." "You think I'm wrong, like it or not. You aren't the man the Romans captured 10 years ago. Rome has changed you."
"That may be so, but I'm still chatty."
"Whatever you were, your people will know the difference now, even if you don't."
He gave a slight wave of his hand.
"But then, what does it matter? The chatty are long dead."
"I'm alive. Others will be also."
"Scattered and disorganized."
Pugnacs felt the silence in the common room and glanced around, noting how his patrons stared at Atreides and whispered among themselves. Atreides noticed as well, though he liked it less than Pugnacs.
"How much will you pay me to stay here?"
Pugnacs laughed.
"You've no subtlety at all, have you? There were games enough in the arena. Below, Atreides and I will have the best wine,"
he announced loudly enough to be heard by anyone in the room. A shiver of alarm raced through Rispa as she felt the ripple of excitement spread. "It is him!" someone whispered as they passed by.
"By the fates, I'd give half of what I own as he invite again," said another.
Well satisfied with the stir he had caused, Pugnacs gestured grandly.
"Come, my friend, sit and have some wine. We'll talk of old times."
Men stared at Atreides and then looked at Rispa as he took hold of her arm, drawing her alongside him as he followed Pugnacs to a table, clearly reserved for more affluent patrons. Reclining on the proffered couch of honor, Atreides gestured for her to join him. She sat, Caleb on her lap, his head leaning comfortably against her breast as he slept. She was uncomfortable being the focus of so much attention.
"I haven't forgotten you,"
Pugnacs said with a hint of envy.
"A fact that will bring you benefit. Think how many will come and buy your wine when they know I'm here,"
Atreides said dryly.
"They will bring gifts to lay at the feet of their idol."
Atreides' eyes narrowed.
"Do you mock me, Pugnacs?"
"No more than I mock myself. The light of glory doesn't shine long on any man. Make the most of it while you can."
"All I want is enough gold to get me home."
Pugnacs' mouth curved.
"One match in the game scheduled for next week and you'd have that. You could name your price. Atreides would pay it."
Rispa glanced at Atreides, concerned that he might consider fighting again. His expression was veiled. Atreides smiled without warmth.
"I prefer that you pay it,"
he replied.
"My terms are simple. An equal share of your profits for as long as I remain in this inn."
When Pugnacs started to protest, he added,
"If you prefer, I'll go down the street and make the same offer to your competitor."
"No need to do that. I agree to your terms."
100 denarii.
100!
"In advance, and arrange for guards. Enough of them to prevent a repeat of my last visit here. I don't want my clothes torn off by a mob of women."
He ignored Rispa's raised eyebrow.
"And see that the woman and her child have comfortable, secure lodgings,"
he added, jerking his head toward Rispa, almost as though an afterthought. Pugnacs took the opportunity to look her over again.
"On the premises, or would you prefer her elsewhere?"
Pugnacs cast him a knowing smile.
"You may wish to entertain admirers."
Atreides understood his meaning and was unaccountably annoyed by it.
"I want her close at hand, but not so close. She's in my bed."
Color filled Rispa's cheeks, and she cast him an annoyed glance.
"Unless I want her there,"
he added.
"Consider it done,"
Pugnacs said, and rose to make the arrangements. Atreides looked at Rispa, his mouth tipping in amusement.
"You look disturbed, my lady. Was it something I said?"
"You know very well what you said and what you were implying to your friend."
"He's not my friend, and I thought it best to let him know you belong to me."
"The fact of my coming here with you said enough."
"It needed stating."
She could feel people staring at them and felt intensely uncomfortable. "Are you sure we'll be safe here?" His mouth tightened as she looked around. "I never realized how well known you would be here." He turned his head slowly. His hard, challenging stare made most patrons turn away.
There are certain advantages to being recognized,
he said coolly, all trace of his earlier amusement gone. What advantages? Beta warned us about Domitian. You're placing your life in the hands of Pugnax, who will no doubt hire criers to go into the city announcing your presence here.
I don't intend to stay long.
You may be in Rome forever if the brother of the Emperor wants you in chains. His eyes blazed.
Woman, why must you always try my patience?
He sat up and leaned toward her. Impossible man. Why must you grow angry at everything that's said to you? You're deliberately putting yourself in danger here, and you've put Caleb in danger with you. Don't expect me to be happy about it. A muscle jerked in his cheek.
I don't care if you're happy or not. The fact is, I need money to get us where we're going. This is the cleanest and fastest way I could think to get it.
Cleanest way?
No doubt you prefer me in the arena.
She would rather he had trusted Theophilus, but knew saying so would only exacerbate his darkening mood. She had already learned Atreides couldn't do anything the easy way, especially if it meant swallowing his monumental pride. No, I don't want you in the arena. I want you safe and at peace with yourself and God.
And you think that would have been the case if I had handed myself over to that bloody centurion of yours?
Theophilus saved your life twice. He said... Atreides made a harsh sound.
The arena would have been the quickest way.
He raked his hands through his hair.
I'd either have the gold to return home, or I'd be dead. Either way, I'd win.
Appalled at his words, she stared at him. You can't mean it.
I mean it. Oh, I mean it.
If it was my wayward tongue that put such a thought in your head, forgive me. Atreides, please, she said, laying her hand against his cheek. You have too much to live for to allow yourself to think that way. Her touch sent a rush of sensation through his body, rousing an intense physical desire, as well as a deeper longing he didn't want to analyze. He looked straight into her eyes. Hers went wide, and she took her hand from him. Why must you always misunderstand me? She said, and looked away. He turned her face back and smiled sardonically.
Maybe I do have something to live for, but I doubt the reasons I can think of right now had any similarities to yours.
He liked the rosy color that poured into her cheeks, the warmth of her skin when he brushed it with his fingertips. She drew back from his touch. People are watching us, she said, embarrassed.
Good. They'll know to stay away from you.
Pugnack showed them upstairs and opened the door into a spacious bedchamber. Rizpah didn't move from the corridor until Atreides took her arm and pulled her into the room.
They're here, my lady,
Pugnack said. He showed Rizpah into a small connecting room meant to accommodate a manservant or a lady's maid and left her there.
Close enough,
she heard him say to Atreides.
Or would you prefer more privacy and her in a chamber not connected to your own? She will be safe where she is. And if you want other women...
Atreides said something low and dismissed him. Pugnax did exactly as she feared.
Atreides has returned to Rome,
a crier called from below their window.
You can see him at the inn of Pugnax, gladiator of the great Circus Maximus.
Within hours, people began to arrive. Pugnax charged a fee for entry into his inn, the price increasing, as did the numbers. Although Atreides agreed to spend several hours in the banquet room so that guests could see him, he made no attempt to entertain anyone with stories of his exploits in the arena. In fact, he made no effort to talk to anyone who approached him. Women were enticed by his reticence. Men resented it. Rizpah remained in the upstairs room, eager to avoid curious eyes and embarrassing speculations. Atreides would return to the room tense, restless, and it worsened with each day that passed. Caleb fussed incessantly. She was afraid he was sick until she felt the two small nubs sink into her breast and realized what was the matter. She rubbed his sore gums. Still, he cried in frustration, and she put him down on a blanket, watching as he crawled off of it and headed across the room toward the carved legs of a couch. When he began to chew on one, she picked him up and put him back on the blanket again. He screamed in outrage. Sure, the sound carried right through the walls. Rizpah snatched up one of the fancy cushions and dangled it above him. Caleb, she said, and swished his nose with the tassel. He stopped crying and reached up to grasp hold. She sat down and watched him chew on the captured cushion. He was not distracted for long. She was exhausted when Atreides entered the room. He threw a pouch of coins onto the bed and stared at her for a moment in silence.
I've been invited to a banquet,
he finally said cryptically. She was sure it wasn't the first or only kind of invitation he had received over the past few days. She had dared go downstairs only once, curious to see his many emirate and how they behaved toward him. It had only taken a few minutes to see the temptations he faced. Women surrounded him. Beautiful, bold women who wanted him. Are you going? He turned his head and looked at her. Did she want him to leave? Was his company so distasteful?
Lady Perenia is not without a certain charm,
he said cynically, testing her reaction. She fought down the sudden desire to jump up, slap his face, and scream at him the way Caleb had been screaming all afternoon. Instead, she rose from the floor and picked up Caleb with as much dignity as she could. Do whatever pleases you, my lord, with Lady Perenia or anyone else who might wish to kiss your feet. She carried the baby into the small servants' quarters. Caleb started to cry again. She tried to hold him close and comfort him, but he screamed louder, pushing at her. Oh, Caleb, she whispered brokenly, fighting back tears.
Why don't you nurse him?
Atreides said, standing in the doorway, smiling faintly. While you stand watching, I think not. His jaw stiffened.
There's more to view downstairs.
Then go downstairs.
Give him some, woman, or he'll scream the walls down around our heads.
Her eyes pricked with angry tears. It won't do any good. He's not hungry. He frowned, straightening. He stepped into the small enclosure and knelt down before her.
Why didn't you tell me something was wrong with him?
Nothing's wrong. He's teething. He hurts, and I can't do anything to soothe...
Give him to me.
I thought you were going to a banquet this evening. He looked at her, brows raised slightly. Heat flooded her cheeks, and she was immediately ashamed. She sounded like a nagging wife, and she was nothing to him. He took Caleb from her, and she lowered her eyes, mortified. As Atreides straightened, she could feel him staring at her, willing her to look up at him. She closed her eyes and fought her roiling emotions. If he didn't leave soon, she would completely humiliate herself by dissolving into tears. He left her small servants' quarters, and she took a ragged breath, relieved that he had said nothing to mock her. She knew it was wrong. Oh, Lord, she knew, but prayed Atreides didn't. She was in love with the wretched man and jealous over the lovely, wealthy women who fawned over and petted him. She had loved Shimi, but it had been a sweet love, full of tenderness as he led her closer to the Lord. She had never felt the fierce, frightening, heart-pounding passions Atreides roused in her. Surely such feelings were not of God. They made her feel vulnerable. The man touched her, and she trembled. He looked at her, and her insides melted. She put her clenched fists against her burning eyes. Atreides stretched out on the bed, waiting for Rizpah to come back into the room, willing her to do so. He put his fretting son on his chest and let him chew on the ivory chip. When Caleb began to quiet, he took the chip away, knowing his crying would bring Rizpah quicker than any command he might give her. The woman didn't have a submissive bone in her body. Just as he thought, a moment later she appeared around the corner. As she did so, he gave the chip back to Caleb to calm him again. She started to turn away.
Count the money and tell me how much there is,
he said, annoyed. He watched her walk to the foot of the bed, pick up the pouch, and pour the gold coins into her hand. She told him how much there was. This is more than you had with you when we left Ephesus.
Not enough to get us to Germania.
She poured the coins back into the pouch. Her expression was telling.
You have something to say,
he said, his voice challenging. She raised her head, her beautiful dark eyes meeting his. Would you listen? She asked quietly.
If your words had any merit.
You have enough now, Atreides, she said, not rising to his provocation. The Lord has provided you with the means to return home.
There are other things to consider,
he said coolly. What things? A muscle tightened in his jaw, but he didn't answer. She moved to the table near the head of the bed and put the pouch on it. Sometimes I find myself wondering if you're so conditioned to fighting for your life that you only feel comfortable when your life is at risk.
Don't talk like a fool.
Is it foolish? The longer we remain, the greater the risk becomes, and you know it. She leaned down to take Caleb. I think money is the least of the reasons we are here, she said, straightening. His eyes flashed.
Then why do you think we're here?
She hesitated and then told him the truth. There's a part of you that wants to fight again.